There is a secret that the church at large has hidden from and deprived Christians the knowledge of almost since its inception. This secret was fundamental to the teaching of Jesus Christ himself and his early apostles. It was the core teaching of the Apostle Paul. Many of the early Christian mystics and mystical teachers knew and taught it, especially William Law and Jacob Beeman of the 1600-1700 era. It is the foundation stone of true Christian experience, the root source or modus operandi of Christian salvation and sanctification, and the only basis or foundation of Christian life. Without the reality of it operable in a life, one cannot indeed even be a Christian in the biblical sense. Despite the absolute necessity of this secret, it is actively known, understood, and practiced by a mere handful of the professing worldwide Christian community. Even fewer could intelligently discuss, explain, or teach it to others. The majority of those that are in any sense familiar with this secret do not even understand its origin, foundation, and inner workings. They know little more than proof text scripture verses, religious jargon, and catchwords that describe the little that they do know. They are like the average computer user who knows how to turn the machine on, push a few buttons, and use the mouse and keyboard. They, however, know absolutely nothing about how or why the computer performs its various functions. To them, it's magic. Now hold on one just minute, someone hearing this message might object. I can get my work done on my computer just fine without understanding anything about how it works. That may be true enough as far as it goes for a computer, but man or woman is not a machine, and in the domain of Christianity, as we will further discuss, he/she needs to take an intelligent, cooperative role. Some aspects of the Christian faith have already been accomplished behind the scenes, so to speak, and require no contribution from or involvement by us. Other aspects, however, do require our active, intelligent knowledge of and participation in to be effective in our lives. I'm going to devote this article to revealing said secret and in examining how its true origin and workings. I will attempt to show how the church has, for the most part, deprived not only Christendom, but the whole world of this treasure hidden in a field, that Jesus Christ, Son of the Creator, came to reveal and make available to all of us. In the place of milk and honey, our religious leaders have given us husks of corn to gnaw upon to feed our spiritual hunger. In the place of the life and that in abundance that our Redeemer came to give, they have burdened and enslaved us, like the Pharisees did the Jews, with cruel and endless lies, dogmas, doctrines, superstitions, rules, and laws, until the end state of man is worse than the beginning. 1,000 times worse, they have attempted to wed the church, the living body of Christ, to this world system, the domain of Satan. The end result is the scarlet harlot of the book of Revelations, being neither one nor the other, but rather a hybrid, adulterated mixture. Over the last 2,000 years, various theories have been put forth to try to explain the betrayal of Jesus by Judas Iscariot. One of these, portrayed in the movie Jesus of Nazareth, was that his betrayal was not really a turning against his master, but rather an attempt by Judas to force Jesus' hand into taking the place of earthly king over Israel, after the order of Solomon, which the people, and even his disciples, expected and wanted, and defeating the hated Romans. Like the vast bulk of Christians today, they failed to understand that the mission of Jesus was primarily a spiritual one. He most definitely did not come to establish a new religion, to usher in a new world order, to cure the ills of society, or to ensure freedom and equality for all upon the earth. He did not come to cure our physical ills, pave the road to fame, success, and prosperity, to save the natural environment, or to pander to your or my particular religious, social, or political agenda. Certainly, God considers many of these things to be valuable, worthwhile human endeavors, which Christians might rightly and correctly give their time to. None of them, however, represent the purpose and end for which Jesus Christ came to earth and was crucified, nor should they represent the core focal point of the Christian life. To my mind, there are two reasons of concern to us as humans for this. Number one, they will never be fully achieved during this phase of creation. Since the dawn of mankind, the problems that face man in society have been with us. Despite changes in manners, social customs, and exterior trappings, mankind has changed very little inwardly. We are still selfish, egocentric, competitive, violent, prideful, and deceptive beings. In the movie mentioned above, one of the characters, Barabbas, a political zealot and murderer, wanted Jesus to lead them in the overthrow of the hated Romans and to become their new king. To this, Jesus replied with the most profound observation, "Governments won't change until the hearts of men change." When Jesus told Barabbas that he needed to love all men, yes, even the hated Romans, he went away quite perplexed. Today, still, mankind in general, and sadly many Christians, understand no better than did Barabbas in that movie. Jesus repeatedly told his listeners, yes, even his disciples, they too were slow of understanding. "My kingdom is not of this world order." He himself spelled out his mission in the early part of his ministry, as recorded in the Gospel of Luke. Number two, when we each personally cross over the barrier between this life and the next, none of our earthly, this world possessions, trappings, or accomplishments will come with us or be of the slightest value. They will be burned into flames as so much waste and rubbish. The exact same can be said for this entire world order when its time is completed and God ushers in the new heavens and the new earth. The Apostle Paul, formerly Saul, a wealthy, powerful, accomplished Jewish leader and teacher before his encounter with the risen Christ, proclaimed in the book of Philippians, "These assets I have come to regard as liabilities because of Christ." Jesus told his disciples to wait until his Holy Spirit, the power from above, should come to fill and enable them to do his work, his way, and under his power. They did wait. The Spirit did come, and the Church of Jesus Christ began to build as a holy communion of new men and new women, transformed and empowered from within by the living presence of God himself. It didn't take many years, however, by 70 AD, until a church became a political structure devoted to fulfilling men's lust for power and control, man's way. Instead of continuing to build upon the foundation that Jesus Christ and his apostles laid, greedy, power-hungry, corrupt politicians, both within and without the church, wolves and charlatans, instead build again the Tower of Babel that they might reach to heaven under their own power and thus make a name for themselves. See Genesis 11, 1 through 8. The living power of God soon gave way to dead power of men's learning and wisdom, dispensed by spiritually dead men and spiritually dead seminaries and monasteries. The living body of Christ, his church, gave way to a political, worldly harlot devoted to man's power, greed, lust, and desire for dominance over other men. Transformed and changed from within lives soon gave way to politically correct dogmas, doctrines, creeds, confessions, and allegiances. The personal, intimate, living relationship with God through Jesus Christ was replaced by liturgy, hierarchy or clergy, meaningless ritual, pagan superstitions, empty sermons, and lifeless hymns. The holy life was replaced by the accepted confession. Soon the layman, the common man, was prohibited even from reading the Bible, God's written word, for himself. The clergy proclaimed that he was too unlearned and ignorant to know what it truly meant. Only the clergy could give the true meaning. This, despite the fact that the original disciples, who overturned the Roman world and built the Christian church, were but unlearned, ignorant, common men themselves. However, they had what had been all but lost, the indwelling life and power of God himself through his Holy Spirit, teaching and working through these men and women. In their arrogant, self-proclaimed wisdom, church leaders now denounced and persecuted anyone who claimed that they had a personal relationship with God, that he communicated with them continually, that his life indwelt them to guide and empower them, that without this presence they could do nothing to build God's kingdom. They were often excommunicated, executed, ostracized, persecuted, labeled as enthusiasts, fanatics, zealots, heretics, indulging in emotional fervor, and being possessed by demonic spirits. The two men whom I am going to reference and quote, William Law and Jacob Beeman, were two such men. During the last 2,000 years, God has continued to sporadically pour out his Holy Spirit upon hungering humanity. But after the initial honeymoon period passes, the bulk of Christians and the church once again lapse into worldly complacency and wander off to be forever lost in the swamp of carnal, earthly, human wisdom and affairs. During the last outpouring, called the Charismatic Movement, starting around 1960, there was a tremendous revival of interest in the gifts of the Spirit in the mainline church. However, instead of leading to a godly, holy, Christ-like church, populated with godly, holy, Christ-like Christians, the ultimate outcome was what I can only describe as the charismatic circus. So-called ministers would compete with each other in person, in the media, and on television and radio to see who could build the biggest ministry and make the biggest name for himself. Fame, prosperity, worldly success, carnal excesses, and greed became the major fruits of this movement. Instead of the church being bathed in God's holiness, it became a theater of Satan, where the foulest, most corrupt, and most reprehensible behavior was put on display for the world to observe. Lately, 2020, once again, inward spiritual growth and Christ-like development has been overshadowed by political activism. The behavior, the mentality, the values, and the life focus of many Christians has become very little different from that of their non-Christian counterparts. Each vie for their favorite political candidate to save them, society, and the world from impending doom and disaster. Their faith and focus is upon what is happening in the political arena, and not upon what is happening in the heavenly places. They revile and condemn those who oppose and or disagree with them with as much, if not more, vehemence and zeal than do their unsaved counterparts, and go into an even greater frenzy of rejection and despair when their candidate loses. It is going to be very difficult, in fact impossible, for me to convey to you all that I want to say in this one message. The reason being that, on your part, it will require a total realignment or change of your religious worldview in order to be able to receive, understand, and accept it. I know that there are some of you who might be reading these words who are even now saying in your heart, "Who does this person think that he is preaching to? I have been a Christian, read my Bible, and attended church for many years, and I already know all of these things." So I thought before I began to seriously study them. I can only refer you to the words of the Apostle Paul. If someone thinks he knows something, he does not yet know to that degree that he needs to know. For this reason, I will be attaching a considerable addendum of selective excerpts from the writings of William Law to this manuscript. If you are truly interested in understanding the points which I am going to endeavor to clarify, I suggest that you devote serious time to studying these excerpts until they saturate your mind and begin to expand and renew your understanding in the area of spiritual things. At first, when I began to read Law's Spirit of Love and Spirit of Prayer, it was almost totally incomprehensible, both because of the totally new concepts and a rather archaic style and language that it's written in. As I invested time and effort into it, however, his ideas became clearer and clearer, and the truth of them and the errors of my former way of thinking became as sharp and differentiated as our light and darkness. I'm sure you experienced the same learning curve when you first began to seriously read and study the Bible. I know that I certainly did. Many years later, when God finally moved upon me to undertake a serious study of the writings of Jacob Beeman, this learning curve was far more severe. I had attempted many times to read some of his works, since Law had derived so many of his ideas from him. Alas, it was to no avail. I had might as well been trying to comprehend Martian. However, when God sensed that I was finally ready to truly set my heart on understanding what Beeman had to reveal, his writings became clearer the more time that I invested in understanding them. As Jesus stated, if you truly want God's deep treasure, you are going to have to search for it and dig for it. Paul clarified that only the spiritual man can truly comprehend the things of the Spirit. One of the major roadblocks to a true spiritual understanding of the Bible and its message is that it is written from the perspective of the Eastern Oriental mind, using Eastern imagery, metaphor, symbolism, and thought. Our minds, on the other hand, are steeped and fossilized in Western culture, characterized by Roman ideas and ways of thinking. The Church, after its corruption in 70 AD at the hands of the Romans, began to adopt its imagery and concepts into its theology. God, instead of being Father, became Judge, Ruler, Sovereign, Caesar, and Dictator. His kingdom, rather than being made up of a family, became fashioned after the courts of the Roman Empire and its judicial system. Sin, now rather than being an error, a missing of the designated mark, of deviation from the intended plan, became a crime requiring judicial investigation and punishment. God no longer looked upon his world and his creation with fatherly eyes of love, compassion, and understanding. Now, his justice needed to be satisfied. His wrath and vengeance needed to be appeased. His injured honor and judicial dignity needed to be placated. And most important, an appropriate victim was needed to pay for the cosmic crime that had been committed against the Caesar God. All of these twisted distortions of the true God shaped the theology of the Church to come. Most sad and pitiful to say, there is almost no corner of God's Church today where this venomous devil's brew is not now permeated and poisoned. Hardly any of God's chosen children whose minds and hearts have not been twisted and distorted by this pack of hellish lies. I believe that I can say with absolute certainty that barely any, if any, of those listening to these words will have ever even heard the concepts that I will be endeavoring to present, or anything different from the standard theology that you now believe. I'm going to try to bring you out of the darkness into the light, where you'll be able to see them for what they are, the delusions, the lies, and the deceptions that Satan has methodically used to blind the eyes of God's children, so that they would not come to know him for what he truly is, and to seek him for the treasure of new life that he longs to give to each and every one. Thankfully, it is still true today as it was in Old Testament times. There is preserved a remnant in whom is kept alive the true knowledge of who God really is and what he is really like. To them, he imparts the love work of seeing that this knowledge and understanding does not die, nor be lost, nor silenced, but continue to be imparted to those of his children with hungry hearts, who have ears to hear and a mind to understand. I am going to primarily examine three major categories: original man, fallen man, redeemed man, meaning women also. These encompass the three principles of sin, redemption, and sanctification, the new life. Category 1, original man, sin. Theology's attack and slander of both the character and the love of God begins right at the start of divine revelation, the book of Genesis and the creation of man. Theology asserts that God is of the character of a warden or a parole officer. Man was his charge, placed in the garden under prohibition. The tree of good and evil was placed there as a test to see whether or not man would be obedient to the will of God or rebel unto his own self-will. God placed the probation, not to eat of the tree, as the main item of this test of obedience. As the sad story goes, man did choose his own will, did eat of the forbidden fruit, and was cast out of the garden by God as a cosmic criminal for his offense. Law and Beeman, and the spirit of Scripture, paint quite a different scenario. They see God as a loving father, delighted in his new child and anxious to guide and mature him in the ways of his, God's, creation. The account in Genesis, rather than being a trial, is instead the explanation of a loving father to his immature son of the ways of this new world and the life that he finds himself created into. In effect, God explains who and what he, Adam, is and how he will need to conduct himself to avoid disaster. God goes on to explain that Adam had been created as a three-part, semi-divine being, inhabiting all three principles or worlds of creation. 1, the divine world of God's Spirit. 2, the dark, chaos, fire world of God's inner nature. 3, the material world of God's created universe. Man's true life was to be the divine life of the Spirit, and it was in this that he was to live and function as his life principle. As long as he did so, he could function in and care for the external creation as its Lord and God, and bring it to increasing measures of maturity and glory. He was, however, not to long for this external world, nor want to be a part of it, nor partake of its existence, nor want his spirit or essence to mingle with its spirit and essence. If he were to do this, due to his nature and the nature of the created world that he inhabited, he would lose his divine spirit and his connection with God and be cast down into the created nature that he longed for. This was not an arbitrary fiat of God himself, but merely the natural outworking of the nature of his existence. Well, sad to say, as children still do today, man ignored his father's wise instruction, chose his own will and way, and suffered the consequences. To miss the mark, or the true nature of sin. Sin, as we will see, is not any particular action or series of actions, but became the actual state of mankind. He had missed the mark of his intended creation, to live in harmony and union with God his Father via the indwelling Holy Spirit life force that he had been given. Man was now separated from God by an impassable gulf, separated from the indwelling life-giving Spirit of God, and isolated in this created world. He could no longer do anything but sin. If you were to ask 100 people what they think sin means, you will probably get at least 100 different definitions. If they are church people, you may get an enumeration of different types of sin, from the lesser or venial to the larger or mortal. Depending upon the religious background, if any, of the individual, sins may range from missing church meetings, smoking, drinking alcohol, gambling, wearing immodest clothing, wearing jewelry, dancing, going to movies, coarse language, swearing, lying, cheating, progressing to stealing, illicit sex, fornication, adultery, rape, killing, and murder. Some might mention the hidden sins: hatred, jealousy, envy, lust, pride, judging unjustly, etc. In almost every case, if not every, however, the person would be discussing acts of sin and not sin itself. Like a great tree, sin has many branches and rootlets, but only one taproot and trunk. Some of the branches are small and fragile and easily broken off. These are like what individuals might deem to be the lesser sins, moderately easy to overcome if you really wish to do so. Other branches are large and strong. These might be likened to what some regard as the mortal sins, very hard to break off. Then there are the hidden sins, not noticed because they are underground like the root system, and therefore often ignored by most people, even Christians. All of this, however, is merely the outgrowth of sin, that original event at the dawn of man's history in which Jesus Christ became man to overcome and eradicate. Category 2, fallen man, redemption. If you understood the preceding explanation of sin, it should answer the oft-repeated question asked by unbelievers and also believers. If God truly wanted to forgive Adam for his actions, why not merely forgive him instead of instituting this complex system of saving man from his sins? Adam's transgression was not merely disobeying some divine ordinance for which God could simply say, "I understand that what you did in ignorance and immaturity. You are my son, I love you, I forgive you." It was also not some cosmic crime for which the divine judge could convene the heavenly tribunal and find man guilty and either impose or suspend just judgment. Nor could God, as some simple-minded teachers teach, merely transfer the necessary compensation into Adam's delinquent account from his, God's, account and tell Adam, "No problem, Adam. I myself have paid the penalty for your offense." No, 1,000 times no. It was not just a breaking of the law. This was, in modern terms, a rip in the fabric of the universe. One of the underlying principles of God's creation had been overturned, destroyed. Paradise had been banished from the earth, and hell brought in to replace it. The fault in this creation could not be mended nor merely repaired. The remedy needed to be as drastic as a new creation. The old needed to be done away with, that the new might be instituted. It is at this point that God begins to reveal his love to fallen, wayward man. He implants the seed of his Spirit into fallen man, to lie dormant and until the times of refreshing should come. At that point, with the coming of the Messiah, Jesus Christ, as fully man and fully divine, the seed takes root, introducing a brand new species of human being into the universe. Where formerly Adam had been the father of the old humanity, Jesus Christ becomes the father of the new humanity. As we die spiritually to the old, we can be born again spiritually through faith in Jesus Christ into the new line. As we, as offspring, partook fully of the nature of our old father, we likewise partake fully of the nature of our new father, again becoming semi-divine beings filled with the Holy Spirit of God. Therefore, the salvation that is brought to us by Jesus Christ is not some legal fiction of a forgiven or paid debt and an imputed righteousness. Jesus did not pay some debt owed to the Father for mankind's transgression. He did not bear the burden of God's supposed wrath and vengeance for breaking his law, and he most certainly did not balance the scales of justice by taking man's place before God's bar of justice and serving the sentence himself. What Jesus Christ really did do was to provide that bridge which man needed, whereby he might once more be united with God, his Father and Creator, by enabling man to again be birthed in possession of and united with God's living Holy Spirit. Man's righteousness, or right standing before God, is not achieved by some magical imputation, but by really, in fact, being able to fulfill God's just requirements and expectations by means of God's living Holy Spirit, indwelling and functioning through man on a continual basis. When Adam and Eve disobeyed God in the garden, they and mankind lost the divine life that they had been created with. They lost the indwelling of God's Spirit. They were therefore separated from the life of God, spiritual death, and ultimately succumbed to physical death. Jesus became man in order that he might become the second Adam, undoing by his perfect life and obedience all that Adam had done in his disobedience. Thus, as sin was really passed on to us from our first father, Adam, righteousness, right standing for God, is really passed on to us from our second father, Jesus Christ. Hence, individuals, by their new birth in Christ, are restored back in union with the divine, with God, and filled again with his Spirit. Through this indwelling Spirit, God works out the transformation of believers toward the putting off of the old man and being renewed according to the image of Jesus Christ. Category 3, redeemed man, sanctification, the new man. At last, we now come to the grand climax, the consummation of this article, the revelation of the great secret, which is its title. It is as the Apostle Paul wrote in Colossians, the mystery, secret, that had been hidden in ages past, but which now God has chosen to reveal to his church, Christ in you. The bulk of the church is still bound up in the same delusion that resulted in the Jewish leaders crucifying their long-awaited Messiah. They would not accept the fact that the external, outward dispensation given through Moses for a while had been brought to an end with the advent of Jesus Christ. Paul clarifies our condition in his letter to the Galatians. God's ultimate remedy for fallen man's condition, alienated condition, his sin condition, had never been external rules and laws, tradition and ritual, outward formalities, or a repair of man's fallen, broken state. No, God had something far more grand, magnificent, and drastic in mind right from the day that he first confronted fallen Adam. He planned to do away with the old, tarnished, broken creation and replace it with a brand new one. It would be one in which a merely created being, man, would be elevated to near divine status as true sons of God, possessing in themselves the divine nature, They would become the heavenly, the corporate body of the second person of the Trinity, the only uncreated Son of God, Jesus Christ himself. Man would again be reunited with his God, Father, and Creator, and would be enabled to fulfill his divine destiny of having God express all of his mighty wonders through his new corporate body, as had been his intention to do through individual men and women before man's fall. The Apostle Paul expounds upon the headship of Christ over his corporate body in a number of his letters. Jesus himself declares to us in the Gospel of John, "I tell you this solemn truth, unless a person is born from above, he cannot even see the kingdom of God. Unless a person is born of water and spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God." Herein lies the root of the problem. Down through the last 2,000 years, much of the church, and even worse, its leaders and teachers, have been themselves devoid of the living Spirit of God. They have declared it vanity, foolishness, enthusiasm, even heresy, to believe that, as Jesus himself and Paul stated, it is essential that a Christian be born from above, with a very real birth and continual infilling by the living Spirit of God himself. Lacking this, they had nothing more than natural, carnal, earthly minds, and could build nothing more nor greater than a natural, carnal, earthly harlot of a church. As the Apostle Peter wrote regarding Paul's letters, "Speaking of these things in all of his, Paul's letters, some things in these letters are hard to understand, things the ignorant and unstable twist to their own destruction, as they also do to the rest of Scripture." Being born again came to mean nothing more than to join some religious organization, be baptized according to their particular ritual, subscribe to their particular creed and confession, and submit to their particular rules and prohibitions. There was no change in the inner man, the true self, nor often, usually, was anything even taught nor mentioned regarding such change. Often, the teachers and our leaders knew of no such change themselves. Churches, monasteries, and seminaries became nothing more than dead religious cemeteries, where the old man, dead in trespass and sins, continued to walk and talk and labor, adding sin to sin, building his Tower of Babel, trying to reach God by his labors and sacrifice. His pride, vanity, and ego could not and would not accept the fact that the needed work had already been done by another, Jesus Christ, and he needed only to embrace and enter into the new life that had already been prepared for him. He needed only to die to all that constituted his old, sinful man, and embrace the promise of the new heavenly man. The Apostle Paul reveals to us the great mystery that was hidden in past ages, that God has created in us a whole new creation out of the old. Not only has our ultimate destiny of becoming truly new men, new creations, inhabiting a new heaven and a new earth of unimaginable glory, power, and splendor been denied to humanity, and especially to the church, but those who dare to speak of a heavenly glimpse that God may have seen fit to give to them are shouted down, ostracized, ridiculed, and often cast out in an attempt to silence them and protect the portals of power so prized by the leaders of this harlot church. They are mocked for preferring pie in the sky by and by rather than getting on with the supposed real work of improving people in society in the real here and now. Social and political activism becomes the work of the church, rather than preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, about release from slavery to sin and entry into his kingdom and government. The new gospel of the church becomes worldly wealth, health, power and success, sexual and racial equality, social and political liberation, and planetary preservation. As I said in the beginning, all of these may have a place in the Christian life, as God so directs, but they are not the gospel, nor are they the prime work of the church, and are all destined to one day pass away. In the gospel, they said to Jesus, "What must we do to accomplish the deeds that God requires?" Jesus replied, "This is the deed that God requires, to believe in the one whom he sent." In the meantime, men's minds and hearts have been turned away from and have hidden from them that which is really the only thing of lasting importance, the new life and the formation of Christ within them, their real hope of glory. In the Gospel of Mark, Jesus himself reveals to us his evaluation of the riches of this world. "Whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life because of me and because of the gospel will save it. For what benefit is it for a person to gain the whole world and yet forfeit his soul? What can a person give in exchange for his soul? Even the grand, unimaginable glories of heaven and our ultimate life with God have been trivialized and reduced to earthly proportions. The most common view taught by most of the church and held among even those Christians who even have a view of it at all is of a slightly improved earthly society in which we will all live happily forever with our former family and friends, free from evil, unhappiness, disease, and death, where all of our wants will be provided for. I am not going to endeavor to describe or speak further of the exact nature of the world and the life which God has in store for us, his sons. It may be something totally unique for each of us. And whatever it may be, speaking for myself, I will state that I possess no frame of reference, nor ability to visualize nor articulate its true nature. We cannot even begin to visualize the realm and nature of God and his glories. We certainly cannot limit nor visualize the world that he has prepared for us. William Law and Jacob Beeman attempted to expound upon the details of such as God gave to them in their visions. This is one of the things that makes reading their works so difficult, particularly those of Beeman. They try to convey what they saw and experienced in the words and concepts at their disposal. But they are trying to relate heavenly glories and earthly words and concepts. They know what they saw. But how do you tell a man who is born blind about colors, or a man born deaf about sounds and music? All that I can recommend that you do is what I have endeavored to do for myself. Allow God to renew your mind. Allow God's indwelling spirit to teach your new man of the heavenly realities. And do not be limited by those Christians around you whose God is their belly and have their minds set on earthly things. Also, diligently and continually read and study your Bible from front to back with an open mind, allowing God to saturate your mind in his perspective and impart to you his worldview. Above all, do not just read your favorite scriptures to reinforce the perspective that you have already formed, or, even worse, that someone else has given to you. Work at diligently and thoughtfully reading and studying the writings of William Law, especially the spirit of love and the spirit of prayer. This will take some real and disciplined work at first because of its seemingly alien nature. I do, however, guarantee you that the end result will be worth the effort. If you really desire a deeper and more mature understanding of God and His Word. If and when God should prompt you that you are ready, expand your reading and study to the writings of Jacob Beeman. This will probably take some real work and dedication, for I found that understanding these was many times more difficult than understanding Law's writings. However, like in any other endeavor, you will reap in proportion to what you sow. If you sow little, you will reap little. However, if you have the insight and determination to sow much, God will see that ultimately you will reap much. My prayers and blessings in God go with you, and your study and your labors. Note: please go to the URL displayed on the screen in order to access the original document in HTML format, including all of the Bible scripture verses cited. There is also an addendum of links referencing a collection of the works of both William Law and Jacob Beeman.